Hi all, this is my second lecture series. In my first lecture, I have explained about names and bindings. In this lecture, I'll be explaining about the scopes of the particular language. So, we'll move on with scope rules. What is a scope? The textual region of a program where binding is active is called as its scope. So if you want to find the scope of an object, you have to find the region or the region where it is active, where its binding is active, that is called as its scope. This scope is determined statically or dynamically. Static scope is determined at compile time itself. So before your program starts executing itself, immediately after completing writing your program, you can look at the program constructs and determine the scope of an object. So such type of determining scope of an object is called as static scope. And the language which follows static scope is C language. The other hand, dynamically scoped languages depends on the flow of execution of program to determine the scope of an object. Okay. So an object scope will be determined as the program executes. So example of dynamically scoped language is APL, Snowball and early dialects of Lisp. So static, scope is determined at compile time. Dynamic, scope is determined at runtime. So next one is referencing environment. Definition I have already quoted in my previous lecture. The set of all active bindings at any given point in a program's execution is called as its referencing environment. Okay. So to determine this referencing environment, we need to identify the different scopes in the language. Okay. So the binding is again categorized into deep and shallow. In this lecture, I'll be giving you an overview or a brief briefing about the deep and shallow binding. The actual explanation, structure and example I'll be explaining in my next lecture series. Okay, so deep binding binds the environment at the time a procedure is passed as an argument. So both these binding will be discussing in the scenario of a subroutine call. Okay, so these bindings will be active when a subroutine call happens. Okay, so in deep binding, it binds the environment at the time a procedure is passed as an argument. So this binding takes the environment of the parent function. Okay, so shallow binding binds the environment at the time a procedure is actually called. Okay, deep, when the procedure is passed as an argument, the binding is done. In shallow, when the procedure is actually called, then the binding is done. So this shallow binding takes the environment of the final calling function. Okay, so deep binding takes the environment of the parent, shallow binding takes the environment of the final calling function. So with this definition, I'm sure that you will not be understanding much in detail about these two bindings. So just remember this, we'll be talking this in detail in my third lecture series. Okay, so as of now, we'll first determine what is static scope and what is dynamic scope, and then we'll go on with differentiating between these two bindings. Now, what is static scoping? As I told earlier, static scope is nothing but the scope of an object will be determined at compile time. Okay, scope of an object will be determined at compile time by just examining the text of the program. Okay, so just we'll be examining the text and then determining the scope of the language, sorry, scope of the object. So the initial language which was found was the basic language. Here the scope rules were very simple. There was only a single scope which is of global, and only a few hundreds of variable names were there. And the variables were declared by virtue of its use. That is, we will not be explicitly providing in float and all. just if you are giving a whole number, it is taken as integer. If you are giving a decimal number, it is taken as float. Like that, by virtue of its use, variable declaration will be considered. This is about basic language. Whereas in Fortran, there is a clear distinguishing factor between local and global variables. That is, Fortran used both local and global variables. Okay. Scope of local variable, as you all know, is limited to its subroutine itself. Okay. So when a subroutine returns, the local variable scope will be lost. Okay. And variable declarations are optional in Fortran. So if a variable is not declared, then the scope is taken to be that of local, and if it starts with the capital letters I to N, then the variable is taken as an integer. If it's or if it doesn't start with this sequence, it is taken as real. So that is with about local variable. But in case of global variables are partitioned into blocks. So if your Fortran program need to use any of these global variable, then it need to actually import those blocks and use those global variables. Okay. And the scope of local variable is limited to a subroutine. But if I need to extend the scope of this local variable beyond the subroutine call, then I can use a keyword called save in Fortran. So if the variable is saved, okay, if the variable is saved, then its lifetime is the entire program, not only to the subroutine. So it is with the entire program. So this similar feature is possible in C with the keyword static, and in Algol it is possible with the keyword own. So you will be wondering why we need to learn these. In the exam point of view, there can be chances that you will be specifically asked about the how these scope rules were in Fortran, or what is the significance of the save statement in Fortran. Like that, questions can be asked. So it is better to understand how these scope rules happens in each and every language. So this is actually the static scope rule. Okay. So the current binding for a name is found in the matching declaration whose block most closely surrounds a given point in the program. Okay. So the current binding for a name is found in the matching declaration whose block most closely surrounds a given point in the program. ഒരു പേരിൻ്റെ ബൈൻഡിംഗ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്, ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ഒരു പേരിൻ ഒരു വേരിയബിളിൻ്റെ സ്കോപ്പ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞെടുത്താൽ അതിന് ക്ലോസ്ലി മാച്ചിങ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബ്ലോക്കിൽ നിന്നായിരിക്കും അതിൻ്റെ സ്കോപ്പ് ഡിറൈവ് ആയി വരുന്നത്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ദി മീനിങ് ഓഫ് ദിസ്. ഓക്കെ, ദ കറണ്ട് ബൈൻഡിങ് ഓഫ് എ നെയിം ഇസ് ഫൗണ്ട് ഇൻ ദി മാച്ചിങ് ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഹൂസ് ബ്ലോക്ക് മോസ്റ്റ് ക്ലോസ്ലി സറൗണ്ട്സ് എ ഗിവൻ പോയിന്റ് ഇൻ ദി പ്രോഗ്രാം. So, if you want to find the scope of an object using static scoping rules, you need to analyze these different constructs. Like nammada program text maatram nokkiyana scope identify cheynathu. The runtime laanengil adu run cheyina anusarichu aa flow anusarichu program aa scope endha annalathu kandupidikkan pattum. But നമ്മളിപ്പോൾ നമ്മുടെ ടെക്സ്റ്റ് വെച്ചിട്ട് മാത്രം നോക്കുന്നതുകൊണ്ട് പ്രോഗ്രാം വെച്ചിട്ട് മാത്രം നോക്കുന്നതുകൊണ്ട് വി നീഡ് ടു നോ ദീസ് പ്രിമിറ്റീവ് ഐറ്റംസ് ഹെഡിങ്സ് സോ ദാറ്റ് വി കെൻ അനലൈസ് ദി ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് ദി പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ പ്രോഗ്രാം ആൻഡ് ഡിറ്റർമിൻ ദി സ്കോപ്പ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ഫസ്റ്റ് വി നീഡ് ടു നോ അബൌട്ട് നെസ്റ്റഡ് സബ്റൂട്ടീൻസ്. നെസ്റ്റഡ് സബ്റൂട്ടീൻസ് ഇൻ ദ സെൻസ്, ഇഫ് എ ഫംഗ്ഷൻ ഇസ് നെസ്റ്റഡ് ഇൻസൈഡ് അനദർ ഫംഗ്ഷൻ. Okay, if in my parent function, if there is an object, will it be active inside the nested function also? So that we need to analyze. Okay, so in order to find a local variable of a subroutine, of the currently executing subroutine, we have something called as a frame pointer. Using frame pointer and displacement addressing, we will be fetching the local variable of the currently executing subroutine. But what is the case with respect to non-local objects? Okay. For example, if I have a main function, from the main function, if I have a nested function called foo, and inside foo, I want to use a variable of the main function, how am I to get that variable inside my function foo? So how to access non-local objects? Next is declaration order. Declaration order view is like, if I have a block B and somewhere inside B and declaring a variable X, okay, so whether this X has scope which includes all the portion before its declaration in the block B or only from the point of the declaration of X in block B. Okay. Onnu illa. Namakku oru block undu B nu paranja oru function undu. Function athu evadiyo maybe oru moono naalo line kazhinjittu oru X nu paranja variable create cheyittundengil aa X inde scope ആ ക്രിയേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത ലൈൻ തൊട്ട് താഴോട്ടുള്ളതാണോ അതോ അതിന് മുകളിലേക്കുള്ള ലൈൻസും കൂടി അതിൻ്റെ സ്കോപ്പിലേക്ക് വരുമോ? ഓക്കെ, സിൻസ് ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് ബീങ് ഡിക്ലയർഡ് ഇൻ സൈഡ് ബി, അതാണ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് റിഗാർഡിങ് ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഓർഡർ. സോ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഓർഡറിൽ വിൽ ബി ഡിഫറൻഷിയേറ്റിംഗ് ബിറ്റ്വീൻ വാട്ട് ഇസ് എ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ഡെഫിനേഷൻ ആൻഡ് വാട്ട് ആർ നെസ്റ്റഡ് ബ്ലോക്സ്. നെസ്റ്റഡ് സബ് റൂട്ടീൻസ് അല്ല, നെസ്റ്റഡ് ബ്ലോക്സ്. ബ്ലോക്ക് ബ്രേസസ് വെച്ചിട്ട് ബ്ലോക്കിനെ ക്രിയേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. So we'll be looking as nested blocks also. Next is modules. Modules is nothing but in large organizations, a project will be split into independent or individual functions. So each person will be working on a particular function. So such independent functions are called as modules. Now how modules are being handled? So that will be taken care there. Last one is about module types and classes, that is how objects are handled and all those things. Okay, so now we'll see each one of these in detail. First is about nested subroutines. So nested subroutines, the ability to nest subroutines inside each other is nested subroutines. It was first introduced in ALGOL 16. Now it became a feature in most languages like Pascal, Ada, Fortran, C and all of its descendants. So for determining the scope of nested subroutines, ALGOL used the closest nested scope rule. So this is an important university question. What is or explain closest nested scope rule with an example? So very simple, the name introduced in a declaration is known in the scope in which it is declared and in each internally nested scope unless it is hidden. Okay, evidiyano oru peru declare cheyathu, evidiyano oru peru declare cheyathu, aa point thottu it will become active. And in each internally, അതിനകത്തേക്ക് അതിനകത്ത് എന്തെങ്കിലും ബ്ലോക്ക് നെസ്റ്റഡ് ആയിട്ടുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ആ ബ്ലോക്കിനകത്തേക്കും അത് ആക്റ്റീവ് ആയിരിക്കും. ഓക്കെ, അൺലെസ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഹിഡൻ. ഇനി ആ ബ്ലോക്കിനകത്ത് അതേ പേരിൽ ഒരു പുതിയ വേരിയബിൾ വരുവാണെങ്കിൽ ദിസ് ഔട്ടർ വേരിയബിൾ വിൽ ബി ഹിഡൻ ഫ്രം ദി ഇന്നർ വൺ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ദി ക്ലോസസ്റ്റ് നെസ്റ്റഡ് സ്കോപ്പ് റൂൾ. നെയിം ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ എ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഈസ് നോൺ ഇൻ ദി സ്കോപ്പ് ഇൻ വിച്ച് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഡിക്ലെയർഡ് and in each internally nested scope unless it is hidden. Clear? So this is an example of that. It is in ALGOL language. So you can see a procedure P1, okay, which is having an argument A1. All other procedures are written inside this P1. So everything others are nested inside this P1. Okay, so P1, its scope will be P1, it is starting here. An argument A1 is passed to this procedure. So the lifetime of this argument will be from P1, starting from P1, from where it is declared to the end of the block. Okay, till where P1 ends, till there the scope will be active. Inside P1, you have a variable X which is local to P1. So this X is its scope is inside P1. So it will be visible in P1 and to all nested functions inside P1. Unless it is hidden by any other variable of the same name. So the scope of X is active from P1 till this function F1. Inside F1, I have another variable X of the same X. So this outer X is invisible to this F1. Till the F1 ends, it will be invisible here. And this portion, we call it as a hole. Okay. If the inner X hides the outer X, that portion is called as a hole. Okay. Again, the outer X results as activation, binding activation from here till the end of P1 definition. Okay. Similarly, P2. P2 is nested inside P1. So, P2 will be active from P1 till the end of P1. Then again A2. A2 is local to P2. It is being passed as an argument to P2. So A2 will be active inside P2 and inside its nested function, which is P3. So A2 will be active only within P2 and P3 and not in P1. So its scope is within from P2 to end of P2. Okay. This procedure start and end is determined by the keywords begin and end. Okay. Then P3. P3 is nested inside P2. Okay. So it will be active from P2. So it is active inside P2. Now A3 is a local variable passed to P3. So A3 will be active to P3 and inside its nested functions. So, since P3 doesn't have any nested function, it will be active only within this P3. Okay. Next is P4. P4 is again similar to P2. It is a nested function of P1. So, P4 will be active from the start of P1 till its end. A4. A4 is local to P4. Okay. So, A4 will be active inside P4 and to all its nested function. So A4 is active from P4 to its end. So to the end of P4 it is active. Similarly, the function F1 is also active from P4, from the beginning of P4 to the end of P4. Whereas the argument A5 is local to F1, so it will be active only within F1. So F1 and to all its nested function. So it is active in P4 region. Okay. This A5 is active to F1 region. So A5 starts from F1 begin to F1 end. It will active till F1 end. Similarly, this local X, it is similar to A5. It is only visible inside F1 alone. So its visibility is within F1 alone. Clear? This is how closest nested scoping rule works with ALGOL. So this whole I have told before, a name to object binding hidden by a nested declaration of the same name. So namukka main lo oru x undu, adu pola main agathulla oru function lo oru x undengil, ആ ഫംഗ്ഷൻ നകത്ത് വരുന്ന ലോക്കൽ എക്സ് ആയിരിക്കും ഫംഗ്ഷനിൽ ആക്റ്റീവ്. ഈ മെയിൻ നകത്തുള്ള എക്സ് വിൽ നോട്ട് ബി ആക്റ്റീവ് ദർ. സോ ടു മേക്ക് ഇറ്റ് ആക്ടിവേറ്റ്, ടു മേക്ക് ഇറ്റ് ആക്റ്റീവ്, ആ മെയിൻ നകത്തുള്ള എക്സും ഫംഗ്ഷനകത്ത് ആക്റ്റീവ് ആവണമെങ്കിൽ ഇപ്പോൾ ഉള്ള കുറച്ച് ലാംഗ്വേജസ് ഇറ്റ് ഹാസ് ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ് സംതിങ് നോൺ ആസ് സ്കോപ്പ് റെസൊല്യൂഷൻ ഓപ്പറേറ്റേഴ്സ്. ഓക്കെ. സോ ഇൻ മോസ്റ്റ് ലാംഗ്വേജസ് ഹിഡൻ ഒബ്ജക്ട്സ് ആർ ഇൻആക്സസിബിൾ ഇൻ നെസ്റ്റഡ് സ്കോപ്പ്, ബട്ട് സം ലാംഗ്വേജസ് അലൗ ടു ആക്സസ് outer name of objects using qualifiers or scope resolution operator. In ADA, my procedure is the procedure name, outer procedure name dot x is the variable of that procedure. Similarly, in C++, you all know you have the scope resolution operator of x, which will fetch you the global declaration of x. So next one is how to access non-local objects. Non-local nu parayumbo a function nath declare eina object illa adine porathottulla object adine engenaana ee function access cheyan povunnathu. Okay, so frame pointer points to the frame of currently executing subroutine at runtime. So this helps to access objects within the current subroutine. But how about objects in lexically surrounding subroutines? That is,
നമുക്ക് ഒരു കോമ്പൗണ്ട് ഉണ്ട്, കോമ്പൗണ്ടിനകത്ത് കുറേ വീടുകളുണ്ട്. സോ ഒരു വീട്ടിനകത്തുള്ളവർക്ക് സംസാരിക്കണമെങ്കിൽ അങ്ങോട്ടും ഇങ്ങോട്ടും ഏത് മുറിയിലാന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് പോയി നോക്കി പോയി സംസാരിക്കാൻ പറ്റും. ഒരു വീട്ടിലുള്ളവർക്ക് തൊട്ട് അടുത്തുള്ള വീട്ടിലുള്ളവരായിട്ട് സംസാരിക്കണമെങ്കിൽ ഹൗ ഇറ്റ് ഈസ് പോസിബിൾ, ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് ആക്സസ് ടു നോൺ ലോക്കൽ ഓബ്ജക്ട്സ്. ദി സൊല്യൂഷൻ ടു ദിസ് ഇസ് യൂസിങ് എ സ്റ്റാറ്റിക് ലിങ്ക് ഇൻ ഈച്ച് ഫ്രെയിം. This link will be pointing to the parent frame. I'll show you an example. So this is the various nesting. So this is my parent function A. A has two child, B and C. Sorry, B and E. This B internally has two nested functions, C and D. So eventually the parent of all these is the A. Okay. So the calling order is like this. A calls E. So in my stack, a frame will be allocated to A. Okay. Then since A is calling E, another frame will be allocated to E. Okay. Now E calls B. So on top of E, another frame will be allocated to B. B calls D. So on top of B, another frame will be allocated to D. And finally, D calls C. On top of D, another frame will be allocated to C. So since this is the currently executing subroutine, frame pointer will be pointing to the subroutine frame of C. Okay. So now the static link of C and D, parent of C and D will be B. Okay. Parent of C and D will point to B. Similarly, parent of B and E are A. So the static link of B and E will be pointing to A. So suppose if the function C, if it want to access any non-local object available in A, okay, C nu parna function na A kathulla edengilum oru variable access cheyanamengil C ividiyana A ividiyana directly vanna access cheyan pattilla. C appo endu cheyum? What it will do is it will follow its static link. Okay, it will follow its static link. C the static link will come to B. Okay, B the static link will go back to A. From A it will fetch the necessary non-local variables that it needs. Okay, so in order to fetch non-local objects, it will actually have to use the static link concept. So the static chains and dynamic chains also we will be dealing in detail in module 3. When you are coming to subroutine control abstractions, you will be dealing that in detail over there. Then you will be having more understanding of this. So next one is declaration order. Declaration order I have already told. So this is an example pictorial view. Okay, I have a main function. I have a variable A. So somewhere inside main I have a function called fun. Somewhere inside fun I have declared a variable C. Now this C, the scope of this C, whether it includes all the statement before C in this function fun or it starts only from this line till the end of this function, that is the question over here. Okay, മനസ്സിലായോ? സി എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ വേരിയബിളിന് അതിൻ്റെ സ്കോപ്പ് എടുക്കുമ്പോൾ ഈ ഫണ്ട് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞുള്ള ഫംഗ്ഷനകത്തുള്ള എല്ലാ അതിനെ ആക്സസ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ സി ഡിക്ലെയർ ചെയ്യുന്നതിന് മുമ്പിലുള്ള എൻറ്റിറ്റീസും അതിനെ ആക്സസ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ആ സി എവിടെ ഡിക്ലെയർ ചെയ്തോ അവിടുന്ന് ബാക്കിയുള്ളത് മാത്രമേ ആക്സസ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റത്തുള്ളൂ. ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ദ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഓവർ ഹിയർ. സോ ഹിയർ സ്കോപ്പ് ഓഫ് ബൈൻഡിങ് ഇസ് ഡിവൈഡഡ് ഇൻ ടു ടു. വൺ ഇസ് ഹോൾ ബ്ലോക്ക് വേർ ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ഡിഫൈൻഡ്. എവിടെ ഡിഫൈൻ ചെയ്താലും എൻറ്റയർ ബ്ലോക്കിന് സ്കോപ്പ് ഉണ്ട്. ഇല്ലെങ്കിൽ സെക്കൻഡ് വൺ ഇസ് ഫ്രം ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ടു എൻഡ് ഓഫ് ബ്ലോക്ക്. എവിടെ ഡിക്ലെയർ ചെയ്തോ അവിടുന്ന് ആ ബ്ലോക്കിൻ്റെ എൻഡ് വരെയാണ്. ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് സ്കോപ്പ്. നെക്സ്റ്റ് വൺ ഇസ് യൂസ് ഓഫ് ബൈൻഡിങ്. ബൈൻഡിങ് മീൻസ് ഇസ് ഇറ്റ് ഓൺലി ആഫ്റ്റർ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഓർ ഇൻ ദി സ്കോപ്പ് ഓഫ് ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ. സോ മെനി ലാംഗ്വേജസ് യൂസസ് ടു എ, ഓക്കെ, ബട്ട് പാസ്കൽ യൂസസ് വൺ എ. ഇൻ ആൽഗോൾ 60 ആൻഡ് ലെസ് ഓൾ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻസ് അപ്പിയർ അറ്റ് ദി ബിഗിനിങ് ഓഫ് ദിയർ സ്കോപ്പ്. വെറസ് ഇൻ പാസ്കൽസ് സോറി പാസ്കൽ നെയിംസ് മസ്റ്റ് ബി ഡിക്ലെയർഡ് ബിഫോർ ദേ ആർ യൂസ്ഡ് ആൻഡ് ദി സ്കോപ്പ് ഓഫ് ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ഇസ് ദി എൻറ്റയർ സറൗണ്ടിങ് ബ്ലോക്ക്. We'll see the example of declare before use in Pascal. So Pascal language la evidiyana oru variable use cheyan povunnathu adinu munpe adu declare cheyidirikkanam. That is the rule used in Pascal. Okay, so here this is an example of a Pascal program. Look at this. You have a constant variable n which is initialized with the value 10. Then somewhere in the course of the program you have a procedure foo. Inside foo you have a constant variable m whose value is initialized with n, and then after some few, two or three statements again n is redeclared to be 20. Okay, so now this redeclaration of n, okay, redeclaration of n hides the outer n. Okay, this redeclaration of n hides the outer n, and so this line 5 will make the compiler to pop up a semantic error, static semantic error. Why? Because the m is being used before it is being declared. Okay, m used cheyidittunde, declaration adinu sheshavana cheyidirikkunnu. So ee oru procedure nagathu ee oru line illayirunnengil it could be true. Ee oru line ulladukonde what happens is ഓൾറെഡി എം ഈക്വൽ ടു എൻ എന്ന് കൊടുത്തെങ്കിലും ഇതേ ഫംഗ്ഷനകത്ത് വേറെവിടെയോ എന്നിനെ റീഡിക്ലെയർ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ പാസ്കൽ എന്ത് ചെയ്യുന്നു പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഫുൾ പ്രോഗ്രാം സ്കാൻ ചെയ്യും. ഒരു വേരിയബിളിൻ്റെ റീഡിക്ലറേഷൻ വേറെവിടെയെങ്കിലും ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ അതിനെയായിരിക്കും അവിടെ ആക്ടിവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യും. അപ്പോൾ ഇൻസൈഡ് ദിസ് ഫൂ, ഇൻസൈഡ് ദിസ് പ്രൊസീജിയർ ഫൂ, ദി എൻ ദാറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ആക്റ്റീവ് ഇസ് ദിസ് എൻ വിച്ച് വിൽ ബി ഹാവിങ് വാല്യൂ 20. അപ്പോൾ അതിന് മുമ്പിൽ ഈ എമ്മിന് എന്നിൻ്റെ വാല്യൂ കൊടുത്തുകൊണ്ട് ദാറ്റ് വിൽ നോട്ട് ടേക്ക് ദിസ് എൻ ബട്ട് ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ആക്ച്വലി ഹാവ് ടു ടേക്ക് ദിസ് എൻ. സോ ദിസ് എൻ ഇസ് നോട്ട് ഡിഫൈൻഡ് ബിഫോർ, ഇസ് നോട്ട് ഡിക്ലെയർഡ് ബിഫോർ ദിസ് യൂസേജ് ഓഫ് എൻ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് വൈ യു ഗെറ്റ് എ സ്റ്റാറ്റിക് സിമാൻറ്റിക് എറർ ഇൻ ദിസ് കേസ്. ഓക്കെ, ഡിഡ് യു അണ്ടർസ്റ്റാൻഡ് വൈ യു ആർ ഗെറ്റിംഗ് എ എറർ? സോ ഈ ഒരു സ്റ്റേറ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് ഇല്ലായിരുന്നെങ്കിൽ എറർ ഉണ്ടാവില്ല. സിൻസ് ഈ ഫൂ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ പ്രൊസീജിയറിനകത്ത് എൻ റീഡിക്ലെയർ ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ഇതിനകത്ത് ആക്റ്റീവ് ആവുന്ന എൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഈ എൻ ആണ്. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പോൾ ഈ എൻ ആക്റ്റീവ് ആവുന്നതിന് മുമ്പേ തന്നെ അതിനെ യൂസ് ചെയ്തിരിക്കും. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഇവിടെ കമ്പൈലർ സ്റ്റാറ്റിക് സെമാൻറ്റിക് എറർ അനൗൺസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. സോ സി ആൻഡ് സി പ്ലസ് പ്ലസ് റിലാക്സസ് സോറി സി പ്ലസ് പ്ലസ് ആൻഡ് ജാവ റിലാക്സസ് ദിസ് റൂൾസ്. It uses define before use requirement. Declare na program, it use define before use requirement. So C, C++, you know, an example of C sharp is given here. Ivide error varathilla, okay, because what, see here you have a constant in n equal to 10. M equal to n nu parayumba ivide adinte scope il varuna n inde value will be taken. You won't get any error over here. Okay, so that is why define before use is being taken. So in C or C++ we'll just declare the variable prior, and then wherever you need to use the variable you just give a definition of that variable. Okay, so Pascal de declared before using the disadvantage karnamana. Pascal the predecessors ella define before use requirement kondu vannathu. So modular 3, the scope of declaration is entire block in which it appears. Python la whole block scope. Scheme nu arna language, this you will be learning in detail in your module 4. You have two concepts, letrec and letstar, for defining whole block and declaration to end of block. Randinum edano avishyam aa oru construct you can use here. So this is an example of scheme program. Scheme is an example of a functional language, that is the entire program, everything you will be writing with the help of functions. Input, output, everything will be defined with the help of functions. Okay, so here you have a definition. Let is a function to assign value to a variable. Okay, so let, okay, let, you are opening the function, passing parameter a and 1. So this will bind the value of value 1 to a. So this binding will be completed once this closing bracket of let is done. So once this let is completed, now the value of a will be set as 1, right? Now again I am using another let, okay? I'm passing another set of argument to this let, value of a to be 2, and I'm assigning value of a to b. So in this scope I have not completed my definition of b here, sorry, definition of let here, okay? So now the value of a will be 1 and the value assigned to b will be 1. So this is just return, print the value of b, so it returns 1. Manasilayo nornjala let vechittu scheme inathu oru variable na value assign cheyuva, just like int a equal to 1, adu pole let vechittana a nu parna variable na value assign cheyunnathu. Appo ivide a ki value 1 assign cheyyu ee first statement eppol assign cheyina ee let inde open and close kaliyumbo maatrame a de value 1 aagutho. Okay, adu pole ini oru let start cheyidu a de value 2 set cheyyu, set cheyidathu final aavanamengil commit aavanamengil endu cheyanam ee let ivide close cheyanam. പക്ഷെ അത് ക്ലോസ് ചെയ്യുന്നതിന് മുമ്പേ തന്നെ എയുടെ വാല്യൂ ബീന് കൊടുക്കും. ബീന് കൊടുക്കുമ്പോൾ ഏത് വാല്യൂ എടുക്കും? ഇത് ഇതുവരെയും കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ആയിട്ടില്ല. അപ്പോൾ ഓൾറെഡി എ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞതിൻ്റെ വാല്യൂ 1 ഉണ്ട്. ആ 1 ആയിരിക്കും ബീന് അസൈൻ ചെയ്യുന്നത്. ഇനി ബി പ്രിൻറ് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ റിട്ടേൺ ചെയ്യുന്ന വാല്യൂ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് 1 ആയിരിക്കും. ക്ലിയർ? സോ യു ഷുഡ് നോ ഡിഫറെൻ്റ് scopes, എങ്ങനെയാണ് സ്കോപ്പ് യൂസ് ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്നത് ഇൻ ഡിഫറെൻറ്റ് ലാംഗ്വേജസ്. യു ഷുഡ് നോ ദീസ് വെൻ യു ആർ ഗോയിങ് ഫോർ ദി എക്സാം സേക്ക്. നൗ ദി ഡിഫറൻസ് ബിറ്റ്വീൻ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ആൻഡ് ഡെഫിനേഷൻ, ദിസ് യു ആൾ വിൽ ബി നോയിങ്. ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ മീൻസ് ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസസ് എ നെയിം ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റ് സ്കോപ്പ്. ഇൻറ്റ് എ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ, എ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞൊരു വേരിയബിൾ ഉണ്ട്, അതിൻ്റെ സ്കോപ്പ് ഗ്ലോബൽ ആണോ ലോക്കൽ ആണോ എന്നുള്ളത് മാത്രം ഡിറ്റർമിൻ ചെയ്യുന്നതാണ് ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ. ഡെഫിനേഷൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഡിസ്ക്രൈബ്സ് ദി ഓബ്ജക്റ്റ്. ആ ഡിക്ലറേഷന് ഒരു വാല്യൂ കൊടുക്കുമ്പോൾ ഇറ്റ് ബിക്കംസ് ഡെഫിനേഷൻ. ഓക്കെ, സോ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ ബിഫോർ യൂസ് ഓഫ് റൂൾ ഓഫ് പാസ്കൽ ഹാസ് ക്രിയേറ്റഡ് സോ മെനി പ്രോബ്ലംസ്. സോ ടു ഓവർകം ദാറ്റ് ഓൺലി ഓൾ ദി ലേറ്റസ്റ്റ് മോഡേൺ പ്രോഗ്രാമിംഗ് ലാംഗ്വേജസ് യൂസ് ദി ഡിഫൈൻ ബിഫോർ യൂസ് റിക്വയർമെൻറ്റ്. ഓക്കെ, സോ ദിസ് ഈസ് എൻ എക്സാമ്പിൾ കോഡ് ഇൻ സി. സോ സ്ട്രക്ട് മാനേജർ, സ്ട്രക്ചർ എല്ലാവർക്കും എഴുതാൻ അറിയാമായിരിക്കും. സ്ട്രക്ട് മാനേജർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് കൊടുക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ ജസ്റ്റ് എ ഡിക്ലറേഷൻ. മാനേജർ ഈസ് എ ഓബ്ജക്റ്റ് ഓഫ് ടൈപ്പ് സ്ട്രക്ട്. ഓക്കെ, ഇനി അതിൻ്റെ ഡെഫിനേഷൻ എന്ന് പറയുന്നതാണ് ദിസ് വൺ. മാനേജറിനകത്ത് എന്താണുള്ളത്? ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ദ ഡെഫിനേഷൻ ഓഫ് സ്ട്രക്ട്. ഓക്കെ, നെക്സ്റ്റ് വൺ, നെസ്റ്റഡ് ബ്ലോക്സ്. ആസ് ഐ ടോൾഡ് യു, ദിസ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് സിമിലർ ടു നെസ്റ്റഡ് സബ്റൂട്ടീൻസ്. ദിസ് ഇസ് ജസ്റ്റ് ബ്ലോക്കിംഗ്. ഓക്കെ, so local variables can be declared not only at the beginning of subroutines but also at the top of any begin end. Idana nested block nu parayunga. Okay, so it is being there in algol 68 c99 c and all its descendants. Okay,
So nested declaration hides any outer declaration. Subroutine pole thanne block in agathu same variable varavanengil outer line variable declaration hide chey. So this is an example of a nested block. Function pole pair onnu illa, just a block begin end. So this nested blocks makes easier for program to read. Program read and help and down, then eliminates the interference with another variable temp. Here I've used a temp over here. Porthoru temp onnengil kandu thammilulla collision will be avoided. Then space allocate deallocate cheyan vendita extra runtime work onnum cheyandalla stack create cheyo angane onnum venda. Already variables nulla aa oru space ne it will be sharing it. Next one, modules. Modules endanu ellarku ariyam. What does module? Function pole split cheythu each module will be independent of each other and they will be interfaced together to combine as one individual application. So benefits of modularization nu parayumbo, this modularization is based on information hiding, like how much information is need to be exposed to each and every programmer. Based on that only modules will be splitted. Now this modularization reduces load on programmer. Full program nokkanda adhe aa programmer na module matram check cheyidavu. He needs to take care of the working of that particular module alone. Okay, now information hiding reduces the risk of name conflicts. So name conflicts undavilla. Okay, so this programmer will be using a name in his module. Same name can be used in another programmer, but that will be inside his module. So name conflicts will be avoided. Then integrity of data abstractions. So that is objects which need to be visible inside will be visible inside, which need to be accessed, so the restricted access outside will be restricted. Compartmentalize runtime errors. Errors vandittundengil edhu module nanandu kandupidichu adile mathram fix cheyidam. These are the benefits of modularization. So this is the simple concept of modularization, encapsulating data and subroutines. Okay. So here this information hiding is limited to objects whose lifetime is same as subroutine. So subroutine the same lifetime varunna, that is local objects. Local objects nana information hiding chain, that is okay. So when control returns from subroutine, its local variables will no longer be live. So control thirichu varumbol local variables will no longer be live. So data subroutines encapsulate cheyumbo, when the module runs, its contents will be, that is its local variables, everything will be active, and when it returns, its variables will be its lifetime will be completed. So partial solution we have already introduced in Fortran. We used a save keyword, C static, algol on. So these are the keywords which provide us a partial solution. Okay, but there are disadvantages of this. So static variables, remember, they are allocated statically on memory. Okay, so this protects memory from access by other, it's not arts, other parts of the program, sorry, so from other parts of the program. But the disadvantage is that it allows only single subroutine abstractions. Okay. So this is not useful in the case if we need an interface to construct more than one subroutine. For example, in the case of a stack, that is the example taken in your textbook. So stack la you have push and pop operations. So ee push um pop um operations lulla variable static aakitte, if you are going to store it onto memory, then it will not be much useful. That is oru single abstraction, oru push or pop angane ullane maatre use cheyan pattathullu. Multiple ആയിട്ട് വരുന്ന പുഷ് പോപ്പ് അങ്ങനെയുള്ളതിന് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ വേറെ അപ്ലിക്കേഷൻസിന് കൊണ്ടുപോകാനോ അങ്ങനെയൊന്നും ഹെൽപ്പ് ആവത്തില്ല. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് എ ഡിസഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ് വിത്ത് സ്റ്റാറ്റിക് വേരിയബിൾസ്. ബട്ട് ഇഫ് യു ആർ
doing it as modules, function side cheyyuvanengil, then you can go for stack based allocation. Okay, so that is the concept of modules as abstractions. Okay, so encapsulate cheyyunnathinum higher version aanu abstraction, modules as abstraction. Okay, so module, as you know, that is a collection of objects, subroutines, variables, types and all those things. So module encapsulates objects inside it. So such objects are visible only to each other inside the module. Then objects inside the module are not visible to objects outside unless exported, and objects outside are not visible inside the module unless imported. So modules are found in almost all languages. In Ada, Java and Perl, these modules are known as package. In C++, C# and PHP, it is known as namespace. So we are taking the example of stack itself. Stack written in modular 2 language. Okay, so this is just a prototype, not the exact program. So you have a constant stack size. Stack create cheyyanamengil, you need to know the stack size. So that is given. Then stack il insert cheya moonu element, adinte type of the element. Then this is my module stack, name of the module is stack. Now I'm going to import element and stack size. So element and stack size is some global variable which I'm going to import it from some other modules. Then I'm exporting my push and pop functions from this module to outside entity. Okay, now again I'm going to create a type. Stack index starts from 1 to, which is an array starting from 1 to this maximum stack size. Then variables, I need S to indicate stack. So it is an array of type element and the maximum size is of stack size. Now top is another variable which is having this type of stack size. Okay, now you are defining a procedure error to indicate any error message. Okay, so that is not elaborated here. Okay, this is just a stack in the contents and nulla prototype matra. Next is I am writing my procedure push. Push cheyyanamengil I need to have an element. So this is the element variable passed to this function, and this is the variable which will accept this argument. Okay, so inside this push I will be using this variable elem. Okay, procedure begins. If my top is equivalent to stack size, top and stack size in same angle, then overflow. So that is the error message. Or else insert, S is my stack array, insert to the array top position, insert this element, increment the value of top by 1. Then end, you are ending this if else and then ending the procedure push. Next procedure pop, that returns the element. Begin the procedure, if top equal to 1, then no element there, underflow, error message. Else top, decrement top by 1 and return S of top. Okay, end the if portion, end the function pop. Now I am initializing my procedure, this procedure stack, initializing the value top as 1 and end the stack module. Okay, so here this is just to show the access. I have two variables x and y of type element. I am pushing the value of x, I am popping the value from the stack and storing it in the variable y. Okay, so this is just a prototype of stack, very easy to understand. Imports and exports, I have already told. If your program, if your module needs to use anything from other modules, then you need to import it. And if your module wants to give any variables, any functions or anything to outside
other modules, then you need to export it. So variables exported are either read-only or opaquely. That is, those variables which are exported can be declared, passed as arguments, compared or assigned to one another, but it cannot be manipulated. Exported variables cannot be manipulated. Okay. So modules using imports are called as having closed scope, and modules without import statements are called as having open scope. Import specifies ways in which program depends on other modules. So it reduces name conflicts. So modules are closed in Modula, Haskell, Euclid, Turing, Perl and Clue, and it is open in ALGOL family. It is selectively open in Ada, Java, C Sharp and Python. Modules as managers. In the previous stack example, we saw that we have created a stack, right? Here we have created a stack and we are pushing elements onto that stack, popping elements from the stack. There is only a single stack existing over here. Otta stack maatre ullu. But reality ile enikku multiple stack varam. C lab le you might have implemented multi-way stacks. So multiple stacks implement cheyandi varum. So in that case, this will not be useful. So I need to create a module as a manager. Stack nu arna or manager module create cheyanam. A stack inathu multiple stack idan pettanam. Okay. So instead of having a single stack, I'll be having a stack module which will be having multiple stacks. Okay. So this concept is found in the language called Clue. So this is an example for that. Same example thaniyana, stack size type element. Module nu arayna stack manager. Avada stack na irunu, here the name is stack manager. You are importing element and stack size, exporting, push, pop. Adu mathramalla different stacks on the multiple stack on the pay. Edu stack ilana push cheyanam. Edu stack nana pop cheyanam. So that stack information need to be provided, and init stack is a function which will actually initialize your stack. Whichever stack you need, that will be initialized. So that is also you are exporting. Then stack index starting from 1 to stack size. Stack is a record. Record in the sense it is a structure which is having S as an array. Okay, array. Stack index of element and top the stack index. So here stack nu parayna oru structure aanu, oro stackilum oru array undav. That is, you have oru single stack nu pagaram you have multiple stacks. Remaining same init procedure, you will be passing out the stack number. Okay, that will be stored in this stk. And the SDK stop, particular stack in the stop will be initialized with 1. Rest is same. Push nathu element matram ayirunu. Here we need to give the stack number also. To which stack you need to push the element. Okay. So this is, everything is similar. You will be understanding. So this is check here. We have two variables A and B of type stack. So A and B are two different stacks. And we have two variables x and y of type element. So x and y are two different elements. Okay. Now I am calling this init stack function to initialize both stacks A and B. And I am pushing x, variable x, to stack A. So A kya the value of x will be pushed, and y kya the B nu varna stack in athulla value will be popped out. Okay. So nerthe kanda example la oru stack maatre use cheyidullu. ഇവിടുത്തെ എക്സാമ്പിളിൽ വി ആർ യൂസിംഗ് ദറ്റ് സ്റ്റാക്ക് എസ് എ മാനേജർ ടു മാനേജ് മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ സ്റ്റാക്സ്. ഓക്കെ, ഇനി ഇതിൻ്റെ ഡിസ്അഡ്വാൻറ്റേജ്, മോഡ്യൂൾ എസ് മാനേജർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ എന്താ, മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ കോപ്പീസ് ഓഫ് പുഷ് ആൻഡ് പോപ്പ് എക്സിക്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യുക. വി ആർ എക്സിക്യൂട്ടിംഗ് മൾട്ടിപ്പിൾ കോപ്പീസ് ഓഫ് പുഷ് ആൻഡ് പോപ്പ്. ഫോർ എ യു ഹാഡ് എ പുഷ് ആൻഡ് പോപ്പ്, ഫോർ ബി യു ആർ ഹാവിംഗ് എ പുഷ് ആൻഡ് പോപ്പ്.
Likewise, how many stack you are creating, so many push and pops are there, will make the program complex. So to avoid that, you are creating a module type, module as a type rather than a manager. So you have a single copy of push and pop function, and all these stack will be utilizing the same copy wherever it needs. So that is module as type. Okay. So Simula, Euclid and ML treats modules as types rather than managers. Okay. So look at this example. Same stack in the Danyana, difference on the Ula, Ade function Danyana. Okay. Everything is same. Okay. But Ade type idakkeyana, but type stack equal to module. Okay, here it is a module. Nerthe we just gave the name as module stack manager. Here we are declaring it to be a type. Okay, type stack, which is a module. Okay, rest is same only. Okay, so ivide see, we are only creating a single copy. Okay, single stack array, not multiple stack. Pala records create illa, pala structures create illa. We are just using a single stack array. Okay, then all the rest is same, just like your first program. Simple stack create cheyda program da adhe thanneya. Difference nu arayna stack module aitana avade declare cheyda, ivide type aita declare cheyna. Okay, ini so here look at the difference. I have two variables A and B of type stack, two variables X and Y of type element. Ini ivide endha cheyina object aayittu, object class um objectum illa C++ la allengil java la class um object. So object endha cheyina, multiple object undengilum ee ella objectum kudi oru class inde functionality share cheyuva cheyunu. Similarly only here, now A dot push in the sense there is only a single copy of push function over there, and this A is going to share that push function. Similarly, B dot pop, single copy of pop will be there, B is going to share that pop. Okay, so adana difference. So aditha module la oru simple stack in the example, aa example vechittu oru single stack e create cheyan pattathullu. Ini stack module as manager aakiyappo multiple stack create cheythu, appo adinte disadvantage nu parnjala multiple copies of push and pop will be created. So it leads to memory and complexity of the program. So adu korakkan vendite we used module as types. Module as types nu parayumbo single copy of push and pop will be shared by all the stack modules. Okay, so the difference which I have told, I have explained it here. Modules are types, modules subroutines belong to the stack, but with module as managers, stack can be passed as argument to the function. There is a separate pair of push and pop operations for every stack. It is wasteful to create multiple copies of the code, so all stacks share a single pair of push and pop operations. So object orientation nu parayumbo, it is a variation of module types. Okay, so here instead of module as types, you will be using objects and class, and it is introduced in Simula, Smalltalk, EFL, C++, Java, C#, Python, etc. So you should know the example of languages having this feature. The object orientation edakka language lundan arayana, adhe pole module as types edakka language a support cheyina, module as manager edakka language a support cheyina. You need to know explicitly oro language ilum endakka feature undu annalathu you need to understand. Ini modules containing classes, so classes vannu kaniyal modules inda avashyamilla, that is not the concept. So you have classes, now no need for modules, that is not the concept. You can incorporate classes within modules, so that is the concept of modules containing classes. So in your textbook they have explained with the help of games. So class definition taken for characters, possessions, buildings and all those things, whereas the graphics and rendering part, strategy,
physics, everything, there is no change, and that will be given as modules. Okay, so each and every class will be designed by a programmer. Similarly, each and every module will be defined by a program. Finally, everything will be merged together to form a gaming application. So this feature is available in C++, Java, C#, Python and Ruby. So with this, we wind up our definition for static scope. So if the static scope is being asked to explain elaborately, you need to write a theory on all these things. What is a static scope? How it is being determined, the scope rule for static scope. Then about nested subroutines, inside nested subroutines, how to access local and non-local objects, declaration order. Coming to declaration order, you will be talking about Python, where declare before use requirement is used, and in C#, C++, where define before use requirement is used. You have two or three examples in that. Then you can explain about the difference between definition and declaration, about nested blocks, and then modules. Coming to modules, what are all the benefits of modularization? Then what are all modules? You can give an example of stack in modular language, or if explicitly asked, you can use modular language, or else if you know to write in C or C++, that is good, you can write in that. Then you have to explain about modules as managers, why module, single module is not good. You can explain about modules as managers, what are all the disadvantages of that, so that you are going to module as types, and then to object orientation. With that, a static scope definition will be done. Now moving on to dynamic scope. Dynamic scoping is nothing but the name and object binding is determined based on the flow of control at runtime, the order of call of each and every subroutine call. Languages supporting are Adas, Nobol, Tex, early dialects of Lisp and Perl. So for these long, I was talking about static scope, dynamic scope, definition, all those things. Now, in reality, I'll show you with an example. This example is taken from your textbook, how with static static scope, how the value will be printed, and with dynamic scope, how the value will be printed. Okay. So this is my program. So I have an integer n, a global integer n. Okay, imagining the entire thing to be my main function, I have a global integer n. Okay, inside I have a nested procedure first with the value of n set to be 1, nested procedure second, value of it has another redeclaration of n. So here this global n is being hidden. Okay, so this second function has the local integer n, and it is making a call to this function first. Okay, now this is the value of global n, which is set to 2, and then a function read integer is called. Now imagine that this function will read the value from user. Okay, it is not written here, but imagine that this function will read a value from user, and if the value is greater than 0, it will call the procedure second, otherwise it will call the procedure first. Okay, and depending on the call, it will print the value of n. Okay, so read integer positive number ana call username nu gettiyengil second call eeyum, negative number anengil first call cheyyum. So imagining first we are executing with a positive number, so user input in a positive number, so read integer reads a positive number, so it directly calls the procedure second. Okay, second procedure call jm endavum, here a local in local n is active over here, and then procedure first is being called. So it will go back to the procedure definition of first. Here the value of n is 1. Ivide ede n aanu active, whether the n which is
passed from second or the global M. So static binding length on a ruler closest nesting nathulla binding on a edikunada. Okay, closest nesting nathulla binding on a edikunada. We procedure first in the closest nested binding or another. This is the nest irikina main nath. Main function and nested function on a procedure first. But idinagatha verena n or in the is the n of main, which is global n. Now the value of global n will be replaced from 2 to 1. Clear? Manasilayo? Call jayina second ennu paranja procedure ninnu aanengilum static scope rule ennu parayunnathu adinte closest lexically closest nested scope ennu aayirikkum varunnu. Appo first ennu paranja procedure nest aayirikkunnathu main nathaanu. So main nath edu n aano active adayirikkum first nath varunna n. So the n which is active here is the global n. So the value of global n will be replaced from 2 to 1. Okay, and then it will return back to second will be returning back to the caller, then it will skip the else part and write the value of n as 1. Ivide n ennu parayunnathu ee n 2 il ninnu 1 vechu replace cheythu kaniyum. So the value will be written as n in 1. Okay, ini adutha run, that is user input edathu negative number aanu vekka. Positive number aanu aadiyam nokkiyathu, negative number aanu vekka. If it is negative number, it will skip the if part and will go to the else part. Else aanengil directly first call cheyyum, first il active aayittu varunna n ennu parayunna global n. So the value of global n from 2 will be replaced to this 1, and then it will come back to here and then write the value of n, which will be 1. So static scope aanu use cheyyunnengil, output of this program will be 1 always, irrespective of whatever input you are providing to the function. Positive aanengil negative aanengil value will be output as 1 with static scope. Ini manasilayo static scope, dynamic scope. You are going with dynamic scope. Dynamic scope il engeniya, depending on the flow of the program. Okay, so imagine first I am going to input a positive number. Positive number nu parayumbo value of this is greater than 0, so it will call second. So second call cheyyum, it will come inside the function definition of second. Here a local n is being activated and then it is calling the first. So it will go inside first. First il varunna n inde scope evidanna edukkunnathu. Okay, since dynamic scope rule take the scope on the flow of execution of the program. So first call aayirikkunnathu second il ninnaanu. So second il ninnu call cheyidukonde what happens, first is being called from second. So since it is being called from the second, the local n which is active in second will be binded to this n in the first. So the value of this local n will be replaced with 1. Okay, value of this local n will be set to 1, but there is no change to the global one, which is already 2. So once this is done, it will come back to here, from here it will come back to here, and here it will come back to this part. Right integer of n, ivide active aayirikkunna n ennu parayunna is the global n inside the main. So here global n value of n is 2, so this will print the value of n as 2 if the input is positive. Okay, now if the input is negative, it will come to the else part, it will call the first function. Now here first is being called from main itself. Main il ninnu call cheyidonde main inagathu active aayittulla n, which is the global n, will be the n of first. So it will replace the value of global n from 2 to 1. Okay, global n inde value 2 il ninnu 1 aayittu maarum, and then which is printed, it will be printing the value as 1. So in dynamic binding, if the input is positive, output will be 2, and if the input is negative, output will be 1. whereas in static binding, always the output will be 1, irrespective of whether positive or negative input. So I have explained this here. Okay. So static scoping prints 1, dynamic scoping, the input is positive, prints 2, otherwise it prints 1. Now, if you understood the previous example, you can solve this one. Okay, so here, look at this, the value of x is given as 10. This is the global x, which is initialized as 10. I have a function f, return the x, function g. It has a local copy of x with value 20, return f. Function main is calling the function g and printing the value here. Print a new line and return. Okay, so we'll see the program flow. Come to main, call the function g with static binding. Okay, first we'll see with static binding. It will come to g, int x equal to 20, local x will be activated, value 20. Then return f. So first it will go to the function called f, return x. Now which is the x over here? Either x of g or x of main, global x. So since it is static binding, x then closest scope evidanaan nokkanam. Okay, closest scope nu parayumbo global aanu, f nu parayna onninathu nested alla, it is global. So it will take the global x. Okay, so it will return the value of global x, which is 10. So it will come here, return 10. It will come here and print the value of 10 with static static scope. Ini dynamic scope aanalo ivide varum g call cheyum, value of x is 20, local x is 20, return f. It will go to f, return x. ഇവിടെ വരുന്ന x എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഡൈനാമിക്കിൽ ഫ്ലോ ഓഫ് എക്സിക്യൂഷൻ. എഫ് എവിടെ നിന്നാണ് കോൾ ചെയ്തതെന്ന് നോക്കും. എഫ് കോൾ ചെയ്തത് ജിയിൽ നിന്നാണ്. സോ ദി എക്സ് വിച്ച് ഇസ് ആക്റ്റീവ് ഇൻ ജി വിൽ ബി ടേക്കൺ ആസ് ദി എക്സ് ഓവർ ഹിയർ. സോ ദി വാല്യൂ ഓഫ് 20 വിൽ ബി റിട്ടേൺ. സോ ഹിയർ റിട്ടേൺ 20 ആൻഡ് ദിസ് വിൽ പ്രിന്റ് 20. സ്റ്റാറ്റിക് സ്കോപ്പ് ആണെങ്കിൽ 10 ഡൈനാമിക് സ്കോപ്പ് ആണെങ്കിൽ 20. ദാറ്റ് വിൽ ബി മൈ ഔട്ട്പുട്ട്. So this is another program. You can try it out as an exercise. Same explanation as follows. If you understood my previous two problems, you can easily work on this. This will be the answer. Okay. Thank you for listening patiently for my lecture series. So with this we have come to an end about names, bindings and scopes. In my next lecture I'll be introducing about what is the difference between shallow and deep binding and how to find out a variable with respect to shallow binding, an object scope with respect to shallow binding and deep binding. So only if you know about static, how to find object scope with static and dynamic scope rules, you can learn with shallow and deep binding. We'll see that in detail in my next lecture. Thank you.